love my drive-through coffee in the morning as much as the next gal, but the cup it comes in, not so much. It could stay in a landfill forever. But hey, maybe the early worm gets the disposable foam. Hey guys, Julia here for D News. Plastic can be great. It's durable, flexible, and used in everything from medical equipment to floss to the cup my coffee comes in. But unfortunately, most plastics either don't or take a very long time to break down. Most plastics are made from processes like heating up petroleum. This rearranges the molecules so it becomes something like polypropylene, which is forged together by strong carbon-carbon bonds. These strong bonds are hard to break apart, and because it takes a lot of energy to make molecules like polypropylene, nature doesn't break them down by itself. Kenneth Peters, an organic geochemist at Stanford University, told Live Science that nature doesn't make things like that, so organisms have never seen that before. But we seem addicted to the stuff. It makes things cheap and disposable. It makes getting your morning cup of joe a little easier. Speaking of those disposable cups of coffee, polystyrene foam is one of the worst offenders. While great at holding hot coffee, it's terrible at breaking down. It could sit there in a landfill for thousands of years. But there is some good news. Two studies published in the journal Environmental Science and Technology suggest the creepy mealworm is to the rescue. The researchers found that the mealworm has microbes in their guts that can break down the foam. How? Well, they fed them nothing but the nasty stuff. But they're not big eaters. 100 worms ate like 34 to 39 milligrams a day, and that's not really a lot. But still, it's better than nothing. After digesting the stuff, the worms released half as carbon dioxide and pooped out the other half as little pellets. Early results say that the pellets might be safe enough to use as soil. What? That's way cool, but still preliminary though. Earlier studies also published in the journal Environmental Science and Technology found other microbes that could help. These microbes live in the guts of another worm, the waxworm, which is a moth larva. These microbes chow down on polyethylene, the most common plastic. It's often used in things like packaging. But these worms aren't alone in their dining habits. There's a fungus in the rainforest in Ecuador that can live off of plastic. Described in the journal Applied in Environmental Microbiology, the fungus, P. microspora, could survive on polyurethane alone. But the researchers say there could be loads of other fungus species that could be great bioremediation candidates, but we just haven't found them yet. The only problem, though, is we're losing precious rainforest at 5,000 kilometers a year, so we might not have enough time to find the fungus we need. But maybe Mother Nature doesn't have all the answers. To take down something man-made, maybe we need to give Mother Nature a hand. For the past 10 years, MIT hosts a competition that encourages students to design a living cell. Yeah, you heard that right, design. Every year, students from all over the world try their hand at genetic engineering in the International Genetically Engineered Machine Competition. While not all students try to make bacteria that eat plastic, in 2013, a group of students at UC Davis tried creating a bacteria that would eat a type of plastic called PET. But genetic engineering can be controversial. What happens if you release it into the wild? We don't know if or how the new organism might mutate, or if it could become an invasive species. And as for more natural bacteria, it's not a silver bullet solution either. We should be very cautious before we go spraying bacteria and fungus over everything plastic. We have no idea how these kinds of organisms could handle a new environment. There's a real fear they could, like, take over. And the fungus from the rainforest? Yeah, it's known to cause rot and disease in a wide variety of plant species. Not good if it gets loose across the planet. So it's clear more research is needed, but researchers seem to be on the right track. Until a perfect solution is found, maybe we should keep plastic out of landfills and out of the environment by the old standby, reduce, reuse, and recycle. But the other question is, does it really help? We are told every day that we should be recycling, but why? What happens to plastic bottles when they're not recycled? Amy's got the answer in this video right here.
Water bottles are typically made of polyethylene terephthalate, or PET, and it's delightfully easy to recycle and reuse. When a PET bottle is recycled, it's sent to a facility where it is ground down into flakes, cleaned, then melted into small pellets.
So what do you think about plastic-eating animals? Let me know down in the comments below. Don't forget to hit those like and subscribe buttons and keep coming back to D News so you don't miss a single episode.